Very, very good morning. I think this is the last time I'm going to be wishing you good morning. From next week onwards, I'm going to be wishing you good afternoon, because we are going to switch over to 2 o'clock instead of 11 o'clock. Today, as you just saw in the poster, we are going to talk about parenting yourself. What does that mean? See, all of us have been through childhood, and obviously we had parents, in inverted commas. It could be our biological parents, it could be grandparents, it could be whoever. But we were parented. Okay, there were these adults who were responsible for us, who controlled us, and who made us what we are, who gave us that, the temperament, the morals, the values, the attitudes, many skills, all that we received in our growing years. Then came a time when we, grew up and we became semi-independent, independent, whatever it is. So once we become adults and we are in a position to take decisions and to do things by ourselves, we carry forward whatever has been done in terms of the parenting that we received. We very often, we mimic our parents. We do whatever our parents had done. Many a time, it is a good thing if parents have taught us some good values, if parents had certain characteristics, which are admirable. It became easy for us because they were our role models. We picked it up and we also started doing similar things. In some cases, we also go against. If I don't like what my parents did, my father was very strict to me, so I am going to be very liberal with my children. My father was a risk taker, and because of that, we ran into financial difficulties. So I will make sure that I will be very financially secure. I will not take unnecessary risks. So either way it goes, but the important part is that it plays a very important role. Now, what happens if certain things are imbibed in us, if they're ingrained in us, so much so that we find ourselves consciously or subconsciously just blindly doing whatever we do without understanding why we are doing it? And what happens is, as it is, the impact on us is there. If we have children, then we start, reflecting or radiating those characteristics down to the children. Now that can become a vicious cycle. Just because my parents had a certain attitude, I pick that up and I want to do exactly the same, or I want to do exactly the reverse of what they did. Either of it is not good. Once we grow up, we have to be a little picky and choosy. We should decide, this is where I received good parenting. This is where I have benefited. This is where good things have happened or are still happening if parents are still there to guide me and help me. But I will form my own opinions. And more so this is because times change very fast. Within the last one generation, lifestyles, values, so many things, family dynamics, so many things have changed so drastically that we can't just blindly copy what was done earlier by our parents. And therefore, for our own good and for the benefit of anybody else, like our children or whoever it is, we need to know how to be able to do the parenting for ourselves and then for our children. So even though I'm an adult and today my parents may not be playing a very big role in whatever I do, it is time for me to parent myself. I should understand. And that's why in the topic, if you saw, I wrote as a blurb, parent, child, and adult states. This is a very old and a very accepted thing, which came out from this thing called transactional analysis. In transactional analysis, they say that you are in three different mental states: the parent state, the adult state, and the child state. The child state is where you behave in an immature manner. You focus only on yourself, like how a small child will throw tantrums and say, No, I want only these chocolates, or I want all the chocolates. Cannot see beyond, cannot understand the good and bad or the right and wrong. So there are times when even as adults, regardless of our age, we regress into what is known as the child state. The other end of the spectrum is where we go into the parent state. We start, advising, controlling, taking care of everything. We become very, very over responsible, not only towards ourselves, but to others also. In between is what we call as an adult state, where we look at issues as a grown-up, mature, balanced adult, and we form our opinion as to what decisions should be taken, what should be the lifestyle, and how things should be. So if we can keep pulling ourselves back from the child state, which we go into sometimes, and the parent state that we go into sometimes, and start looking at what do I need to do now in terms of my own, reformation, all these things, and what I can do for others in that bargain. In order to do that, we have to do what is known as the concept of reparenting ourselves. We have to start off with reparenting. Whatever was there, whatever parenting we have received is fine, but now we should start the process as independent and responsible adults to start off with reparenting our own selves. So from the internet, I picked up a quick little, 2 minute video which Anis has got for us, and she will that one explains to you how and what is the concept of reparenting. Here it is.
Bound relationships, the right sort of confidence, and to extend adequate nurture to ourselves. We would like, of course, to move on. There is something unbalanced and deeply cruel in the idea of the first 12 years determining the next 50. We cannot change the past, but it does remain open to us to correct at least some of its repercussions. We may learn to do this through a neglected and yet deeply powerful process we call reparenting. How our parents behaved will have laid down a template in our minds about how we should respond to challenges. But we don't need to remain forever stuck with the kind of care which we imbibed in the early years. We by nature have an ability to parent ourselves. What this means is an ability to comfort ourselves at moments of difficulty, to interpret the troubles that beset us with imagination and kindness, to encourage ourselves in the face of anxiety and loss, and to reassure the more fragile, agitated parts of us by drawing upon our experience and our serene aspects. All this is what good parents naturally do for their children. But if this didn't happen to us, we can still, in adulthood, step in and do it for ourselves. One part of the mind can speak to the other. One part can act as the sane, resilient counterweight to the bruised and more immature side of the self. We can figuratively put an arm around our own shoulder.
Putting an arm around your own shoulder. That is how we start the reparenting process. Identifying what we have received without any prejudice or bias or judgment on our parents. They may have done it with good intentions, times may have been different. They may not have been able to understand. After all, you know that no parent is given formal training as to how to be a parent. So they just did it by trial and error, and they did whatever they felt is best. Now, just because I'm grown up and I'm an adult and I have my own, responsibilities and all that, that does not mean that my process of growing up should stop. But who will do it for me? The only person is my own self. In order to do that, the one thing, I emphasize on all the time is, see, when we are grown up and when we are growing up, what do? We set goals, starting with the most obvious, that is the career goals, or a goal about when should I marry and whom should I marry or what children I should have. All these are very natural and, regular goals that we set. But I want to take you into the aspect of setting certain goals which are defined by the journey So not setting a specific goal, like saying that I want to have a three-bedroom house of my own, or I want to marry at this age, or I want my child to, you know, do this. Those are specific goals. I think what we should do is our goals should be more what we call as process-oriented goals. The same way as when you were a child, because of the parenting and because of the inputs that you were getting from your elders, you were open to change. Every time something new came up, some teacher told you something, some grandparent told you something. As a child, generally, we are very open. We say, oh, these people are saying it, so it must be good, so let me try it out. Somehow, as adults, we stop doing that. And that should never happen. We should not stop, you know, this process of growing, altering, finding out. And the way to do that is to enjoy the journey. Keep resetting the path. In my process of moving towards some goals, do I need to move a little to the left or a little to the right? Do I need to stop and take some rest so that I have more energy to go ahead? Do I need to look for the road which has got least hurdles and least, you know, resistance? These are the things which are more important. And that comes out of this process of what we call as reparenting ourselves. So if you start looking at those things, one very important thing I can tell you is that as we grow up as adults and as we grow older, you know that we start sometimes developing a sense of loneliness. When we are children, we can make friends with anybody and everybody. It just doesn't make a difference. When we are in adolescence, we enter into what is known as the peer age, where we form our gangs and our groups, and we are very selective about whom we want and whom we don't want. We even start checking out which relative I want to interact with and which relative I want to keep away. Now, as soon as this process starts, we are building walls around us. And slowly, 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 the number of people who are there with us or who interact with us start reducing. So if we don't go through this process of reparenting, if we don't stop and reflect, one fine day it is quite possible that you may find yourself very isolated and very lonely. Now, if you care for yourself, if you love yourself, if you feel that you're a worthy human being, then what you need to do is to start this process of continuous changes, route alignments, checking the speed of where you are going. Sometimes we are running too fast in life. Sometimes, as the old proverb says, take time off to stop and smell the flowers. When you're going past some plants or flowers, do you take the time to just stop, admire the plant, smell the flowers, and then move on? When you see a small, very cute child or something, do you stop and just look at the child and see the innocence of that child, the bubbly nature of that child? That is what we need to, you know, do. Most of us do it to some lesser or greater extent. And I have been talking to my colleagues also on this topic. That's what we usually do. You know, we've got a wonderful team here at Banjara. So we spend very little time doing work, and we spend a lot of time chit-chatting with each other and having endless cups of tea. So while we do that, we do talk about things which are meaningful to life. So I have been talking to my colleagues, I've been taking their opinions, after which I formulated today's structure of today's module. One of them I thought I will share with you, one of our younger colleagues, who is now a mentor, faculty, and counselor with us, her name is Sufia. I just had a chat with her and recorded what she had to say. Can we listen to Sufia for a minute?
Sufia, there are certain situations where I feel demotivated and which makes me feel low, and I'm not able to function properly comparatively to the natural, the regular routine of mine. So at that time, I self-soothe myself, like, you know, by saying that I'm so grateful for this day and this moment. Maybe after I miss this moment, I'm never going to retain it again back. So why not just utilize this at the most and perform things which I love rather than just thinking and sitting alone in a corner or, you know, getting those flashbacks which are not okay for me. So at that time, I started comparing myself that how grateful I am, and that gratitude keeps me on, and you know, I feel refreshed and I get back to my routine and do things which I love. Thank you.
Yes, there is this Sufia, parent of a small child who is obviously seeking her attention and asking her, why are you talking to the camera instead of talking to me? So if we get too caught up in our roles, if I say, oh, I am a mother, I am a professional, I am a head of the family, and I am this, I am that. If we get, you know, drowned in our roles, then we lose our own identity. And that is why I was saying that, you know, one is it can lead to loneliness. It could also lead to a sense of low self-worth. I had mentioned this quite some time back. If you remember, I'll repeat it. I had gone to a friend's place on a Sunday morning, and his wife came to me and said, "Ke bhai sahab, you are a counselor. You know, my child, my girl, she has come to PUC and she's hardly studying. This is the time for her to, you know, make her life and to do things. Can you please advise her?" Now, before I could tell her that counselors don't advise people, she called out to her daughter, and the daughter was there. Sunday morning, she's enjoying whatever she is doing, you know, watching Netflix or chatting with friends or whatever she was doing. And here mommy is, you know, calling her to come and sit with some boring uncle. So you can understand what mood she came in. But the mother gave, you know, a very wonderful statement. "You know, I am already 39 years old. And there was a time when I was a bright student. I used to be very ambitious. I wanted to be a doctor and all that happened. But, you know, I came from a very conservative family. I was not allowed to do all that. Anyway, I got married very young and I had this child and I had no other ambition left. So I just take care of my family and my life is over. I have nothing to look forward to and I don't mind it. But I want my child to do very well in life. We are very progressive. We don't mind sending her to America if required. But we want her to have a good future. Unlike me, you know, whose life is over, I want her to have a good future." Okay, I heard her out. I spoke a few minutes to the child. I could make out that she's not receptive. Then I said, "Okay, think over it. We'll meet again," and all that. And the moment I said, "You go," she was very thrilled and she ran off from there. After she left, I told the mother, "You know, what a wonderful role modeling you are doing. You are telling your teenage daughter that I wanted to do this, I wanted to do that, but I was put down, I was this and that, whatever happened to me. At 39 years of age, my life is over. I have nothing to look forward to. I have no ambitions left. I will now only focus on my children." What does that mean to the child? That if I work very hard, if I do whatever I want, if I struggle, by the time I'm 39, my life will be over. I'll be only taking care of children and all that. So at least now as a teenager, let me enjoy life. That's the message that reaches the child. But the issue is not of the child. The issue is of the mother. Why can you not reparent yourself rather than focusing all the time at, you know, parenting the child or children or whoever you are you know, involved with. At the same time, let me also tell you, which I keep repeating, that when we talk about parenting, no, I'm a strong believer that there is, parenting is not a single word. There is fathering and there is mothering. Combined together, it becomes parenting and they complement each other. You cannot give enough to a child unless the masculine element of the fathering is there and the feminine concept of the mothering is there. That is what leads to a child growing up into a balanced and mature adult. Now look back and see, not all of us are very fortunate to have had equal inputs of fathering and mothering. Supposing either was lacking a little bit, either was a little less than what you expected, I want you to fill that gap up by yourself. It doesn't matter what gender you are. You can fill in that gap of, you know, the fathering or the mothering. And here, one most important thing I wanted to just tell you before we move on to how to deal with it at a practical level. If you had trauma in childhood, any form of trauma, you were put down, you were compared, you were abused, you had some sort of molestation, anything like that in your childhood, all the more reason that you should do the reparenting, because you have to heal from that. You don't even realize how much baggage we carry from our childhood into our adult years, right up to our sunset years. So reflect on that, where you were lacking, whether fathering was not adequate, mothering was not adequate, or if there was anything negative that happened to you in life, all the more reason you need to work on it. So we come to the final part of it. How do I work on this? So as usual, I made out a few very simple bullet points. We'll run through them once and see, you know, what are the tips and points which are necessary. Tips to be a good parent to your own self. Start with the first one. Accept and acknowledge your inner child's feelings. Please give a little thought to thinking over what we mean by this inner child. Inner child is that innocent part of you. The, you know, very, very non-judgmental, very, very simple, straightforward part of you, which keeps you childlike. Please remember the difference between being childlike and childish. Childish people are immature. Childlike people are not only very mature, they also enjoy life. So accept and acknowledge your inner child's feeling, what your inner child is telling you from time to time. You as an individual, don't think about your age. I'm already 32 or 46 or 62 or whatever. Your inner child remains alive unless you crush it. Keep acknowledging and listening to your inner child. Then model good behavior even when no one else is around. It's an established fact that most of us behave differently when people are around, and we behave differently when people are not around. It's okay, sometimes we have to do it, there's no answer, but still I would say, can you practice in isolation or in solitude, practicing the same behavior, the same methodology that you would do if you were with people? Try it out and see. That is one way of correcting yourself, reflecting on yourself, understanding yourself as to where you stand and what you have been doing so far. Then the next one you see over here, set reasonable expectations and have consistent boundaries. If you have unreasonable expectations out of life, no, then you can't be happy at any time. You're always striving, you're always struggling, you're always waiting for, you know, I should achieve that, only if I get this, then I will be happy and things like that. Similarly, set consistent boundaries. Boundaries which don't keep changing every day. Whether it's your value system, whether it's your attitude, whether it's your earning capacity, whether it's your relationship with others and all that. Have consistent boundaries. I will do this, I will not do that. Most people whose lives go astray or who get into trouble or become unhappy in the long run are people who do not stick to their boundaries. They keep breaking the boundaries. A person who is a social drinker says, it is a festival or it is my party and today it doesn't matter if I drink as much as I want. He has broken those boundaries and because of that he gets into trouble. Now, if you are parenting yourself, you can visualize if your parent was there and you are doing something which is beyond your boundaries, the parent would correct you, isn't it? So become your own parent in that way. The next one, as you see on the screen, is keep a regular schedule, as if somebody is controlling you. If somebody is controlling you, there's a nice proverb that says, whenever you do something, Visualize whether you will do it in your mother's presence. That itself gives you a very clear indicator. No, if my mother is around, I can't do this. That means that you yourself know that you are stepping beyond the boundaries, right? So, if you decide to be your own mother and father, then you will not do it. So that's what I mean by saying, keep a regular schedule as if someone is controlling you. You can have variety in your life, you can do other things, but you must keep that schedule as far as the important things and as far as the boundaries are concerned. At the same time, create routines and rituals like children have. That's what I meant by this concept of the inner child. Children have certain routines, children have certain rituals, and children also have their own excitements and their little games and their what to do with the free time. No child ever says that I'm getting bored. If you find that in your leisure time, when you are stuck with nothing to do immediately, you only pick up the mobile and start surfing, there is something wrong. That's not what you should be doing. That means you are not happy in your own company. Only if you can enjoy solitude, do things without any gadgets, and be at peace, like I mentioned, be in nature, smell the flowers. There are innumerable things to do. I won't, you know, go into the detail because I want you to find out what is good for you and what you would, you know, like to do. At the same time, pamper yourself. Be gentle with yourself. That's how parents are, no? Parents can scold you very badly. After that, they'll again become gentle. At the end of a scolding, probably, you know, your mother called you and said, come, come, come. You haven't eaten anything. I'll make something nice and hot for you. Do that to yourself. On the one side, be strict. On the other side, keep pampering. This I've seen in a lot of people, you know, somewhere have low self-esteem. They don't pamper themselves. If I ask them, when was the last time that you gave a gift to yourself? When it was your birthday, what did you do for your own self? And they don't. And these are the people who need reparenting on a very, very regular and massive scale. Now, we may have had certain values, certain morals, or whatever it is that was inculcated into us. As an adult, it is trying to review those. Sometimes what we call as morals are only superstitions, or they are outdated practices. If there is a time to change, have the courage to change that. Don't follow things blindly because these are moral, these are values, this has to be done, that has to be done. No, it's time for you to take your own life in your control. And like I was mentioning earlier, develop some simple hobbies, childlike. In my days, we used to have comics. Parents always used to be behind us, don't read comics, read something nice. But we used to be so thrilled with comics. Why? Because before the advent of the TVs and the gadgets, comics were the only ones which gave us a visual input. Understand the significance of that. But the visual input, you can also get from outdoors. You can get from nature. You can get from scenery. You can get from people. Keep that in mind and develop certain hobbies which are away from all possible screens. And lastly, strengthen your support system. As children, we are automatically given a support system. If daddy or mommy is busy, you have papa, aji, grandmother, uncle, aunt, neighbor, anybody. As adults, sometimes we don't have that support system. So ensure that even now, as an independent, proactive adult, you still keep strengthening your support system. These are the very basic and very simple ways by which you can, you know, achieve whatever I've been talking about. And with that, give me a minute's break. And today, Purnima is here with you to share a few good things. I'll be back in a minute.
Good morning. I'll shift that side, Ani, so it's better. Hi, I got an opportunity to be with you all today, feeling really very nice. Good morning, Florence. Yes, a wonderful subject, right? Yeah, not frequently discussed. I agree to that, but then the significance of this topic is so vast, right? Yeah, true. And I also come to you with some news about Banjara. So the most important one I'll give you at the end, but a couple of them I thought I should just share with you, because we always want to let you know what are the things that are happening at Banjara, what are the new developments that are happening at the academy. And one of them, as I think we have been telling you, is that our 25th Silver Jubilee batch of diploma in counseling skills has begun, and all the four teams have begun. So it's good to have new students and each one with a new thought process. And you know, many of them are coming to class after 15, 20 years. So in a classroom setup, so they are like, okay, now what do I do? Where do I sit? Do I make friends? Will she speak to me? You know, they have their own apprehensions and they have their own thought processes. And we also try to make them as comfortable as possible. So that is one thing. It's quite nice to be a part of this journey of the 25th batch. It started in 1999, the last century. So that's where it started. And since DCS is on way and on track, moving on, we are also going to be coming up with some few courses. Now, why these courses? See, what's happened is anyone who's already been an alumni, who's already been associated with Banjara, whenever they come down, they ask us, "Are Ali, why don't you start some course? Purni, koi naya course aa raha hai kya?" You know. So I was just sharing this with one of our alumni members. I told you, come down, we will have a course to decide what courses to have. So she was saying, no, I have to be, associated with you all. And learning through the Banjara courses and processes is a very nice thing for me. So we are going to be coming out, and we were telling Ali and I, we were discussing that, you know, why not we have something which can be of help. And Ali is, you know Ali, right? You want it, I will give it to you. So that's how it is. So one thing which is coming up is, see, you know, we do a lot of career counseling, right? We have so many students who want to do psychology, and more so clinical psychology. So what's happening is that they don't have too much idea, and they are just wondering where they will get practical exposure to this whole thing. And because there are quite a few of them who want, so we also know that there may be so many students now who are out of Bangalore also. So we can do as much for those who come to our academy to Bangalore. We do get calls from other places. So what we have done is that Ali is going to steer a webinar on the 11th of August. Okay, from 4 to 5:30 in the evening. And this is going to cover all the careers in clinical psychology, which is fabulous, right? If so many of them really want to reach out to people at the emotional level, and they want to help people, you know, with whatever difficult situations that they face with relationships, with their life, with so many different things, it's really wonderful. So we are having this webinar coming up, which is on the 11th of August, which is slated as Careers in Clinical Psychology. And one thing which I told you, the important one, I'll bring it at the end, that all those who want to get pampered, who want to feel childlike, and who have not visited Banjara in a long time, I can't even say raise your hands, okay, but you can raise it through your chat. If you have not come to Banjara in a long time, I would just say take some time out, drop in. Come, have a cup of chai, we'll sit on the bench, we'll pamper you, okay? So you also pamper yourself. We'll bring out the childlike, in you, and come down to the academy. We do see you online, but we would also like to see you offline. Yes, Ali, we'll all have a chai with them.
Yes. Always ready.
And over to Ali for all your questions and answers from him.
In fact, in the last 10 years or more, we have one compulsory member of the team Banjara who's always there with us for the evening tea. Her name is Dottie. She's our indie street dog who roams around all over the locality, but in the evening tea time, she's always there to enjoy and share. Every one of us has to keep the last two sips and we pour it out to her and she laps it up. That's what life is all about, isn't it? So let's start the second part of the thing. Sonia says, can we have one topic? Parenting your parents. Yes. So would you like your parents also to attend that, or would you just like to learn, you know, get some techniques as to how you can parent your parents? Either way, I'm okay. It's a very challenging and very interesting thing. And there are going to be a lot of parents who are going to get very angry with me, because if I teach you how to parent your parents and they'll ask you, why this change in behavior? Who taught you this? And if you say Ali, they are going to get behind me. But I don't mind taking the risk. I will do it. I made a note of it also. Sheila says, take time off to stop and smell the flowers. Wow. Just be present to what the life unfolds every moment and live life to our fullest potential. That is what somewhere or the other we are missing out. Take a simple example that, you know, people have been complaining. Those who live in Bangalore have been complaining last few days of incessant rains. And they consider it to be an irritant. Traffic jams, it is so wet, it is this, it is that. Yeah, unless the rains are flooding your house and you have to run away from there, then my sympathies are with you. But if that is not happening, please learn to enjoy rain. They are bounties of nature. Without rain, we would have been starved. So be happy that we are getting so much of rain. And even on a day-to-day basis, there are so many advantages of, you know, enjoying the rain if we really want to. Sheila also says, agree with Sonia. I am also in a stage of life, parenting children, husband, parents and in-laws. 10, 20, 50, 70 and 80 age group. Want to be more skillful instead of wanting to run away sometimes. Yes, Sheila, as you all know, there is no place to run away. The moment I start thinking that, no, I'm getting fed up, I can't deal with this, I want to run away somewhere, you're just fooling yourself. There is absolutely no place to run away, because I'll tell you one important thing, you cannot run away from yourself. Unless and until you learn to be, that's what I had said a few minutes back, if you learn to be in solitude and at peace without gadgetry, you don't need to run away anywhere, even if life is throwing a lot of challenges and hurdles on you. Sheila also says, never realized reparenting is so important to drop it all and feel light and energized. And also, let me add to what Sheila says, it is a continuous process. Remember that also. It's not that I did it 3 years back and now I'm happy and I'm energized. No, energy again goes down and again you have to recharge yourself periodically. Florence is here. Good morning, Florence. A wonderful subject, not frequently discussed. I like the title. Yes, somebody had suggested it. I don't remember now, one of our team members, and I also liked it very much. Okay, next is Vinita. Yes, Vinita is also part of Banjara and a regular volunteer with us, and she does a lot of work. Vinita says, actually, Ali, parenting never stops at any point of time, and doing it for self is a very excellent thought. Thank you for showing this path too. Most welcome, Vinita. We all do it together. I get so many inputs from all of you. It's not that I am such a great person that I give out my gyan, but I always learn and love to share. Mez says, such a good topic. Never ever given this a thought, and so many good inputs from Ali. Yes, thank you, Mez. You, Mez, has also been a good pillar of Banjara. She has done a lot of volunteering with us and all that. And we look up to her as a very dear friend. Asha says, disciplining our own self, probably we forget that there is no need to pamper our own self. and we may miss the bus. Very rightly said, Asha. This is something which I keep on telling. I come across so many people who are wonderful human beings, but somewhere they do not value themselves the way they value others. The moment they come to know their sister or their friend or their neighbor has some issue, they'll go all out to do whatever the needs are. But when something happens to themselves, or nothing happens, but they want to give themselves a boost, they say, no, it's okay. What is there? What is so great about it? Yeah, I love to eat that particular ice cream, but I don't have company. That's why I'm not going. Why do you need company? You like that ice cream. You go enjoy yourself. These are very small, but very significant things. Okay. Kiran said, techniques. Yes, that's the techniques that we have given you. If you want, I'll request Anis to run through the slide at the end of the program once more for those who want to take screenshots or copy it down. Surekha is another very, very dear friend of mine and also a strong supporter of Banjara. Surekha says, our job as parents is to deliver our children to the next stage of life intact and equipped as they possibly could be. How can I prepare myself for the next stage, which would involve a lot of self-nurture and healing from the loss of a loved one? That's what I was saying, no? That everything that has happened to us in life, a tragedy like the loss of a loved one, the growing up of children and they're flying away from the nest, each of these things we need to prepare and we need to understand and we need to adapt ourselves. I've been mentioning that change is the only permanent thing in life, and it is no longer, you know, sufficient to adapt to change. We should anticipate change. How many of us, before a tragedy strikes us, even visualize that I may lose a loved one? If we don't do that, what happens is that when it strikes us, we are shaken up completely. So in our counseling training, one of the things that we go through is how to deal with loss, death, grief. Now, you may help somebody else with it. You may help yourself if the situation arises. These are the things that we need to keep in mind if we want to ensure that our life goes smoothly. Preeti says, parenting ourselves can heal our inner child. Yes, Preeti, it can go a long way in healing the inner child. If your inner child is, you know, suffering, like I said, any form of put downers, any comparison with people, any, you know, people, you know, negating you or any form of trauma that you may have gone through, all this goes a long way in healing, to whatever extent. At least it may not heal completely, but it can definitely heal, at least to some extent. Lakshmi says, such a beautiful stumble. It's past midnight in the US and I woke up abruptly to this. Fond memories of Ali sir and Manjara, loving this session. Thank you very much, Lakshmi. People like you, you know, other end of the globe, but you have not forgotten us and you still connect with us and you still participate in these sort of things. It really gives us a lot of enthusiasm and motivation. Roshan, she's another dear friend and a good, you know, support to Manjara. She says, being childlike even now makes me very happy and energetic. All the time I love to enjoy life, every moment of it. When it is raining heavily and never get bored, as I have knitting, embroidery and cooking to do. This is how we need to adapt. You know that some days there will be continuous rain and you can't step out. So what will you do? There will be days when it's very pleasant outside. So how will you go out and what will you do? There will be days when you're so tied down with work that it becomes a burden on you and you get exhausted. At the end of such a day, what will you do? These are things that we need to anticipate and adapt. Sucheta says, as it was suggested, I do realize my gratitude, but it's sometimes exhausting as there is no appreciation. How to motivate as expecting from others is not fair. No, expecting from others is fair. It's not unfair. But how much to expect from whom? How much is one individual willing to give us? If I put all my eggs in one basket and I start expecting only from that person, because that person happens to be very close to me, then I miss out on the others. Remember that there are always genuine, caring people around you. If you have been good to others, if you have been maintaining a positive relationship with others, they will reciprocate. So instead of looking for appreciation from only specific people, learn to accept appreciation from wherever it comes. Surekha says, can becoming more easy going by a good way of transforming into a nurturing reparent? Yes, Surekha, it can. It can become easygoing, become childlike. Learn to take yourself and your life easily. Don't take your responsibilities too heavily. I'm a parent, I have to do this. I'm an executive, I have to do that. I'm a homemaker, the whole house, rests on my shoulders. Don't take your roles so seriously. And then only you'll be able to take yourselves seriously. Priti says, rain is therapeutic. If you look at it like a child would, ask yourself, in all these days of heavy rains that we have been having, how many times did you make a paper boat and float it in the water which was flowing in front of your house? I did it. Okay, now let me also, tell you. Sheila says that, wow, so well put, Surekha, as always. We are going through this. Yes, Sheila, I also appreciate always, Surekha's comments, and I get so much inputs from her from time to time. Okay, now I have one more comment. Hello, Ali. Happy to listen to you. Almost Saturdays, I make sure to attend your sessions, which make get reconnected with Banjara. Yes, we would all like to keep being reconnected with each one of you at all times, in whatever way. Like Purni said, come down and just come and have a chat with us or share a cup of tea with us. If not, call us and have a chat or update us on what's happening in your life. We would definitely be happy to know anything that is happening in your life. We would also like to share your concerns if anything negative is happening in your life. We would like to be there with you to whatever little extent we can. Surekha has a good comment. How can I reparent myself when the inevitable pain is moving towards suffering? You remember, Surekha, I had said that pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. One person has severe pain but does not suffer. Another person has lesser pain but suffers more, because pain is physical. Suffering is mental. You cannot have control over your body. If your body is giving you trouble, if it is aching, paining, if you're ill, it's there. You have to accept it. But you do have full control over your mind. And if the mind says that, no, this is not suffering. Supposing a child needs extensive attention from the mother. The baby is there and the baby needs the mother's attention 24/7. Does the mother suffer because of that? No. The mother says, I like doing it. It's my baby. I want to see my baby grow up into a healthy child. Even if somebody comes and offers that, no, you leave your baby with me, the mother will say, no, thank you, I appreciate your offer, but I want to take care of my baby alone. So see, this is how the mind controls. If we program the mind to understand that pain is there, yes, but suffering is within my control. Right, we have Alka. Alka has been a very good student, very dear friend, and she has been doing extensive and wonderful work with the Defense Forces for the last 10 years, and I'm really proud of her. Alka says, I learned from Banjara how to be Niswarth, that means, selfless relationship with our own self as well as others. Thank you so much. Yes, Alka, thank you also for bringing these points back to us from time to time, and that helps us to keep moving in the right direction, right? Jyoti says, my sister in USA, 20 years of marriage. Now she realized she wasted her life living for family, kids, nothing done for herself, happiness. How to motivate her? This she only feels when having argument with the husband and the kids. Yes, that's how it happens. When you're having arguments and there's unpleasantness, you start reflecting and you say that, oh, what have I done last 20 years? I've only been there for the other thing. But that's not the way to deal with the life. when you're not having arguments, when there's nothing unpleasant, when you have time to yourself. Maybe if you can take time away from the family, it could be going and sitting in the park for 2 hours. It could be getting away on a weekend to be with yourself or to be with a friend somewhere. That is the time when you need to reflect. What have you done in the last 20 years? Once you realize that I could have done much more than this, it is never too late. Just because the last 20 years you have spent for your family, it doesn't mean that the next 40 years you cannot live for yourself. Start bringing in slow, steady, minute changes. Sheila says, wow, pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. I have the choice of attitude I want to have in any given situation. Thanks. Which includes physical pain. There are people who have severe physical pain, but they say it doesn't matter. It's for a cause. I'm doing it to take care of this, or I'm doing it for that thing. The excellent example is the defense forces, where you may have heard, you know, officers getting Paramveer Chakra and all that because their body was getting hit by bullet after bullet. I mean, understand the extensive pain. But the officer kept on walking forward, exhorting his men, shooting. It was almost like, unbelievable. Where did he get this strength from? He's got half a dozen bullets in him. But he kept doing it till his last strength. That is what we mean by suffering is optional. Vinod says, good morning, Ali. It's so amazing how you come out with such interesting and innovative subjects week after week. Never thought of something like parenting self so far, and it's adding so much of value. Thank you, Vinod. Vinod is another very strong pillar. I really enjoy his company. We do a lot of workshops and programs. In fact, next week we are going out, and Vinod is going to help me from there to log in to be with you all at 2 o'clock instead of 11 o'clock next Saturday. Dr. Shireen, she's another very dear friend, and she has been with us for many, many years. We seek her guidance and advice on medical matters every now and then, and she has never refused, to give this selfless niswar, as Anka said, to help out in any cause for anybody. Now, what Shireen says is, when one has had ideal and loving parents, when life's challenges hit one, can we go into our childhood and get comfort? Or is it futile to go into the past? Is it running away from our present? Not at all, Shireen. You can take refuge in your past. Close your eyes, visualize that you are again a small child. You have your father, mother pampering you, taking care of you, doing so many things for you. When you start thinking about that, the suffering, as I was telling you just now, reduces. The impact of what you are going through reduces. But that does not mean that you live in a world of fantasy. It's not like getting drunk and escaping from the problem. It's just using those good memories to strengthen yourself, come back to the present, and again face whatever the challenges you're facing right now. Asha says, crossing the line between tradition and modern parenting is not easy. Yes, Asha, I agree with you, but it's not impossible either. Take it one step at a time. Do it slowly. Maybe you have elders who keep telling you that, no, you should not break tradition. You should do it the way we did it. Fine, we are not going to fight with them. But slowly, slowly, here and there, we inch towards, bringing about the change. And when the change has good results, then we show them that, see, by this change, we are getting these results. We are getting these positive outcomes. So let me try more and more. Do it on a continuous basis. Surita has a very important question. How can we reparent ourselves when anxiety overwhelms us? I agree with Surekha. You cannot do reparenting when you are in an extremely anxiety-ridden state. So what you need to do is first deal with anxiety. There are ways and means of dealing. In fact, I've written a workbook on how to overcome and deal with anxiety. Anyone of you interested, you can always get in touch with Venu in the office. He'll give you either a hard copy or soft copy, whatever you want. Now, there are ways and means, as I said, I won't go into the detail now, but take it as a priority. Make sure that your anxiety levels have come down to manageable levels, and then go through the process again of reparenting. Sheila says, yes, my brother, Colonel and Surgeon, was part of the Kargil War. You can talk to people like that and you will see what all they have done and what their thinking, their attitude was. Normally, one would say, why should I risk my life? You know, why should I take care of this? Why should I suffer because of this? But they, as I said, they don't suffer. They consider it a joy to be able to do something for their country and for their people. Hello, Ali. Kumar here. Oh, Kumar, very good. Happy to connect back with you, Kumar. Kumar has done his DCS 17 years back in 2006 batch. Can you please give some tips on how to convince our parents about present day happenings? Usually old people get happy only if we do things according to age old daily practices to make them understand. Here again, see, instead of spending a lot of time explaining to you, I have written this book called Life Begins at 60. Don't give it to your parents, you read it. There are some wonderful pointers in that, which you can slowly imbibe into your parents. If your parents are the reading type and they are open to it, give it to them. Definitely they will benefit, but otherwise it's okay. If they say, why are you giving this book? What do you think, you know, we are doing wrong? Don't bother. Once you understand a few things of how to deal with, you know, issues which your parents are pressing down on you and which are not very reasonable for you, there are ways and means of doing it. Or we can talk about it someday, get in touch. We will discuss it specifically in your case, understanding what, where your parents come from and what their needs are. So that, I think, has been a wonderful hour. We had wonderful interaction. I myself learned so much from some of the comments and the questions that came up. And that's how I keep learning. I keep jotting down. I keep, you know, learning and growing and evolving at every step. And more so from these Saturday sessions. And once more, before I log out, I want to remind you that next week onwards, every Saturday, we are going to meet at 2 o'clock, the same schedule, 2 to 2:30. I will talk and convey whatever I've gathered from all good sources. 2:30, we will start with our interaction and whatever you have to say, your comments, your questions, your disagreements, we go through all that. And those who cannot log in because that time is not convenient to you, it remains on the Facebook page. Anytime after that, even a day or two later, anytime you can log in and go through the thing. So it's my pleasure to be with you all. And here I sign off for today. Bye-bye.